Welcome to Care Talk, America's best place for incisive debate about healthcare business and policy. I'm David Williams, president of Health Business Group.
And I'm John Driscoll, the CEO of CareCentrics.
John, for the last couple of weeks, we've seen protests across the country really related to racism triggered by some horrific footage that everybody is aware of. You know, our expertise is really on the healthcare side, and we know that many racial and ethnic minorities fare worse than white people on health measures. Now, how significant is that? And really, more importantly, what's behind it?
Well, I think it's hugely significant. I mean, one of the things that's driving the fury in the streets is the police brutality. And that's got to stop. Any aberrant cop, any cruelty, put that aside for the moment. There is a huge challenge of racial fairness and access to healthcare. Let me give you a couple of statistics. If you hold, as we've talked about before, for the same income and education, people of color get worse care uniformly. The National Association of Medicine studied 400 hospitals across the United States and found that consistently across cardiac, kidney care, stroke, cancer, infectious disease, people of color got lower access, less access to modern medicine and tests, and worse care in general. That structural inequity has to be addressed. We got to call it out for what it is, which is the healthcare equivalent of segregation, of access to care. So let's fix that, David. And I think you'll start to see more of a sense of opportunity and fairness that currently doesn't exist. And we got to call that out. As healthcare leaders, we've got to fix this.
John, the health disparities are something that have been studied for quite a while. And I saw a good article on Kaiser Family Foundation site from Samantha Artiga, who documented what was happening in terms of disparities. It counted up health measures like physical health, mental health, and saw that on many, many of these measures, Black people, Hispanics fare worse than whites in these areas. And it's gotten actually the same or worse over time, despite supposed progress. Yeah, you put a lot of attention on healthcare, but I think actually that these more social determinants of health, which don't have that much to do with healthcare, but more things like economics, housing, jobs, education, those are actually probably more important and kind of hard to solve. They've been with us for a long time.
But David, slow down. How about just the fact of access to doctors that look like you? You know, currently medical school admission is very difficult, but that people of color, Black people represent 14% of the population and only 7% of the medical school students. Why don't we increase access for folks of color to medical school? People of color carry nearly twice the debt burden of those who are white, who look like you and me. And how about the fact that if we fix that, which is eminently fixable given the rich institutions that these people are going to, that folks are graduating from, these incredibly overly endowed institutions, why don't we make the debt problem for people of color go away? Because what you also find is that people of color are twice as likely as white students to actually want to serve in underserved communities. That is something that it's a structural opportunity, if you will, to actually fix the system. We should do that right now.
John, there's a lot of demand to do things right away. It's understandable. It's what we should do. And at the same time, you can't get away from these social determinants. So you can look at what's going on in medical school, and you can say there's not a lot of Black people in medical school. You know, there's not a lot of people of color in general. And yet, there's not that many applicants. And why? And it's because even if you go back to early childhood, even for things like infant mortality, and certainly education, access to food and housing, and so on. And you know, there's a number of people in prison that should be in medical school instead. You can't take care of these things with just saying that these schools like Harvard are rich and should use their endowments in order for medical school. It's a quick fix. It's not going to work. And honestly, it's going to put too much pressure on the few people that are there to try to make it happen.
Don't be afraid to hold Harvard up to do something for folks of color. Well, here's another idea that's really straightforward. How about the first 1,000 days of life A baby's brain, a human's brain grows faster than any other time of life. How about we make sure that no baby is hungry for the first 1,000 days of life? Very doable. We've got SNAP benefits that are limited right now. We know how to feed young children. If we just feed young kids three squares, nutritious meals, we will increase the IQ of the young talent coming out of poor neighborhoods around the country. Depending on how you measure it, we've got one of 3 to 5 kids in America is growing up in a food insecure household. If we can make those households less food insecure, heck, we make more, we create more food in this country than we can even consume. Why don't we get it to those poor communities? That would have a direct impact on long-term health outcomes and, frankly, opportunity, because you're basically investing in the brains of those children who are being fed.
John, I like your enthusiasm. I think it is worth examining what's happened over the last, 40 years or so in this country, starting with people being talked about as welfare queens and food stamps being looked down on and calling our previous president the food stamp president and so on. Now, this baby in the first 1,000 days isn't going to feed himself or herself, certainly not in the first several hundred. So you really have to look at it on the whole family basis. And then you have to look also at programs like Medicaid that are good programs, but that have their expansion of Medicaid under the Affordable Care Act has been blocked in a number of states. And I think in today's heightened environment of understanding of looking at things through the lens of racism, there's some racism involved in withholding Medicaid. Feeding the kids sounds great, John. No one can be opposed to it, but I don't think it's as simple as that.
I actually think it is simple, but I agree with you that we also need to feed the family. It's really hard to believe you're going to be a very successful working class person and get out of the working poor if you can't afford to feed your family. So I actually think we could get, particularly if we were to go at it with a multi-pronged approach, bipartisan support, that families should not be hungry. That's something I actually think I'm more optimistic on that. On Medicaid expansion, absolutely. It'd be great to have everybody to have stable, affordable access to healthcare. Because if we don't, those poor people who don't have access to Medicaid, we're still going to pay for it when they're sick, only it'll feed into a chronic cycle of being sick. It'll fall into uncompensated care, which is a false name, because we know we all pay for it. It just gets compensated through taxpayers in a different way. So I totally agree with you. But we can feed Americans.
John, for the last couple of months, we've been talking about COVID-19, and suddenly the switch has gone to talking about racism in this country. How separate are these two topics?
Well, I think they're tied. And I think that the fact that you're by a multiple times, whether it's 3 to 5 times more likely to die of COVID if you are of color, has kind of strip the cover of the access to healthcare, the segregated access to healthcare that actually exists indirectly and directly in the current healthcare system. But there are multiple factors that go into why it's more dangerous to people of color. One is the fact that they live in poor neighborhoods, they live in dense neighborhoods, there's more community transition. I would guess that folks of color are more represented in the essential workers who actually never were able to shelter at home, of those who were trying to put food, wanted to make sure they could consistently put food on the table, but were in lower income. There's a lot of reasons that go into it, but for me, it also ties right back to the fact that the system, the healthcare system we have in America, doesn't treat people of color fairly. Let's be honest about that and start to make a move to fix it right now.
John, the virus has been very mysterious. When it started, people didn't know how it was spread, how long it took, who it affected, how to treat it, and so on. But for those of us who've been in healthcare for a while, it was absolutely no surprise that it was going to have a higher impact on people of color. And that's because you can see it everywhere: HIV, heart disease, cancer. And it's not just in how they're treated by the healthcare system, as you're talking about, which is part of it. It's also because of these social determinants of health that put people in a more dangerous situation to begin with. And so I think there's a real linkage between the sudden understanding about racism and the COVID-19 pandemic.
I agree with you.
Well, that's it for another edition of Care Talk. We've been talking today about racial and ethnic minorities and the impact that we're seeing in healthcare, COVID-19, and beyond. I'm David Williams, president of Health Business Group.
And I'm John Driscoll, the CEO of CareCentrics. Thanks for listening.
Hey there, listeners. Want more Care Talk? There's more to be had in our other episodes, so be sure to look for those and subscribe to Care Talk on your favorite service.